Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Anup. I work for Western Digital. So me and my colleagues at Western Digital, we contribute a lot to open source projects for helping the RISC-V ecosystem as such, software ecosystem. And this talk is all about Xvisor, RISC-V, it's embedded hypervisor for the RISC-V world. So RISC-V as such is quite suited for the embedded world. And having an embedded hypervisor for a RISC-V world would be great. So this is sort of outline of the talk. We'll have a quick overview of the RISC-V edge extension, so what is there in RISC-V for supporting hypervisors, and then look at Xvisor in general, have a quick overview of that as well, and then look at the RISC-V port of Xvisor, and lastly, look at our current status and what do we plan to do in future. And if time permits, we'll also have a quick demo of RISC-V running on QMU. So let's begin with RISC-V edge extension. So even before going to RISC-V edge extension, I'm sure most of you are already aware of RISC-V, what it is and what it stands for. But nevertheless, it's a free and open instruction set architecture. It's a clean set, extensible ISA. It is designed to support 32-bit, 64-bit, and even in future 128-bit machines. Just like any other RISC, it has 32 general purpose registers. It also has variable instruction length, which can actually lead to a quite compressed code size, binary sizes. And then we have three privilege modes, machine mode, supervisor mode, and user mode. So machine mode will typically run the platform-specific runtime firmware, whereas the Linux operating system or any general purpose operating system will run in S mode, and the apps or user space will run in U mode. Each mode has its own CSRs. Okay, we won't go into details of each of them. But to highlight, the box on the right shows that to run Linux, we just need 9 CSRs of S mode. Yeah, so that was a quick overview of what is RISC-V for people who don't know RISC-V. Like I mentioned, it's an extensible ISA, so it has a lot of optional extensions being defined for RISC-V. So one of them is the hypervisor extension, or the H extension, as we call it. So it's an optional extension. The CPU implementers can choose not to implement or implement it based on their requirement. It's designed to suit it for both type 1 as well as type 2 hypervisors, bare metal is. The current state of the spec is it's at 0.4 draft stage. We'll be soon having a 0.5 draft as well with some of the pending changes, but it's pretty much not changing much as of now. When Western Digital initially started off the work for the hypervisor extension, we added support for QMU and Xvisor first, and also had a KVM, we also have a KVM port for RISC-V as well. So that was all based on 0.3 draft. Recently we have moved all these things to 0.4 draft. And yeah, once 0.5 is out, we'll move to that as well. And we don't hope to see much more change in the spec as well, and we hope that it will be frozen soon. So it's almost like at Western Digital, we are doing a co-development between the with the RISC-V spec and the software. We are actually validating the spec by implementing it in QMU for both type 1 as well as type 2 hypervisors. And it actually helps us provide a lot of feedback to the spec community. And this helps us ensure that the spec is in right shape and it is suited for both type 1 as well as type 2. So over here, so RISC-V extension actually changes the privilege levels, what I described, M mode, S mode, and U mode. So it adds a new HS mode. It's nothing but the S mode with additional hypervisor capabilities. And then we also have VS mode and VU mode. So VS mode runs the guest kernel or guest Linux, and VU mode will run the guest user space. So it's designed such that guest Linux or Linux can run unmodified as a hypervisor in KVM, or it can also run unmodified as a guest in VS mode as well. So that's why it suits both, actually, type 1 as well as type 2. And the color coding over here will be consistent across the slides. We have a separate color code for the sub-privilege mode that will be consistent across the slides. So there are new CSRs, of course, in the S mode, which are only accessible to the HS mode. So there are two types of new CSRs added for hypervisor extension. One is H prefix CSRs, which provide the hypervisor capabilities to the HS mode. And then we have VS prefix CSR, which allows HS mode to access the state of the VS mode. And when we are running in VS mode, all the accesses to the S mode CSRs will map to VS CSRs. And these are pretty much all the CSRs that are newly added for H extension. And just like any other architecture with virtualization support, we also have a two-staged MMU in hardware. So when we are running in VS mode, we'll have the VS mode page table, or the stage one, as we call it in ARM world, which will be programmed by the guest itself. And it will translate guest virtual address to guest physical address. And then we have HS mode guest page table, which is nothing but the stage two. It will translate the guest physical address to host physical address. And yes, it is programmed by Hypervisor. So, and in general, the in HS mode or the Hypervisor, we can program two different types of page tables. So HS mode page table is for the Hypervisor itself, which will translate Hypervisor virtual addresses to host physical addresses. And guest page table will be for the VMs only. We'll have one guest page table, and for most Hypervisor, one guest page table, which translates per guest to translate guest physical address to host physical address. And the interesting part is, like, all these various page table types, the page table format remains same. There is not much, and we can reuse a lot of the code across hypervisors. And injecting virtual interrupts to guest vCPUs or guests is very straightforward. We just directly update the VSIP CSR from HS mode to inject per CPU virtual interrupts. And for software and timer interrupts, or the IPIs within the guest and the timer interrupts for the guest, we have SBI calls, which will be explained later. And of course, we'll have a lot of software emulated devices as well, which will be trapped and emulated using the HS mode guest page table. So right now, the biggest or most critical IP that we are emulating in software is PLIC, or the interrupt controller for the VM. And we also have emulated whatever devices for the guest or VM. So moving on to Xvisor in general, what is this project about, and in general overview of Xvisor. So Xvisor stands for Extensible Versatile Hypervisor. It's an open source GPLv2 type 1 monolithic hypervisor. So the word monolithic is quite critical here. That's how Xvisor differentiates with other open source hypervisors like Xen. It's a community-driven project. It's not driven by any org. It's there in development since more than nine years now. It supports variety of architectures which are widely used, like ARM V5, V6, V7, VE, V7 V with V, then ARM V8. We also have support for x86 64-bit, and then RISC-V is work in progress. So it's primarily designed and developed for embedded virtualization. So it's not targeted at servers or the thing where there are a lot of resources, too many CPUs, or huge amount of RAM and lot of devices. It's primarily, the goal of the project is to give good virtualization performance in resource constrained systems, typically embedded systems. Our first academic or the peer-reviewed paper was in 2015. Where we showcased and did an apple-to-apple comparison between KVM, Xen, and Xvisor on the same board, same machine, and showed how it performs better on micro benchmarks. So this is a traditional classification which most of us are aware of. Hypervisor is either a type 1 or type 2. As I mentioned, it's a type 1, just like Xen. KVM is type 2. But there are a lot of differences between Xvisor and Xen as well. Xen is more like a micro-kernelized hypervisor. It runs most of the drivers inside a guest. But we have a provision to run drivers directly in Xvisor. You can choose to use pass-through and even run the drivers even in the guest or VM. So like I mentioned, we are in development since quite some time now. And of course, we have lots of features now. Some of the features are listed here, like virtualization infrastructure related features. We use the device trees for both host as well as guest. We have a soft real-time pluggable scheduler. You can always add your scheduling policy anytime. Then we have huge page support for both guest as well as host. Then we have tickless and high resolution timekeeping. We don't have the timer wheel baggage or anything like Linux. And we have a host device driver framework. So we have the right size device driver, which is just enough required for the devices that we care about. We don't have a device driver framework like Linux for all the devices on the earth. And we also have a Linux portability headers, which will help you port the drivers easily from Linux to Xvisor. Then we have threading framework to create background threads, like kernel threads. And then we have runtime loadable module as well, which works in ARM as well as Intel. It's still not there in RISC-V, but we'll add it. So you can plug, like KO objects, you can have XO objects, which you can plug it from file system. We have also a very lightweight virtual file system that's just for logging and loading guest images. It's not for sharing with host, because it's not scalable that way. And then we have a white box testing framework as well to stress our own internal modules. And then we have domain isolation related features, like we can assign affinity to vCPU, each vCPU, and also the host interrupts. We also have spatial and memorial, temporal memory isolation. By this I mean that most of these SOC have a cache hierarchy up to level 3, level 2, and L2, L1. So when we are running a virtualized system, so we can ensure that all VMs get a fair share of the cache hierarchy using spatial and temporal memory isolation. Then we have standard device virtualization related features like pass-through support. So pass-through support is not there in RISC-V because we don't have a defined IMMU in the RISC-V world as of now. Maybe in future we'll have that. But it's there for ARM world. We have it in Xvisor ARM. Then we have block device virtualization, all the standards of network, input, display. On para virtualization, we follow Voltaire spec. As of now, we have 0.9.5, the older Voltaire spec. We should be moving to 1.0 spec as well. And the other interesting feature we have is the domain messaging, where we have a unique way of passing messages between the VMs. So we don't have any Xvisor specific para vault calls. We use Voltaio RP message for message passing between the VMs. So using Voltaio RP message, we can actually bypass the networking stack. So if we can always use Voltaio net, but if you use Voltaio RP message, you can bypass and have a faster communication between the VMs as well. And we also have shared memory, so we can actually achieve zero copy inter-guest communication using shared memory Voltaio RP message. So some of the key aspects that differentiate Xvisor is that everything in terms of the Xvisor scheduler is a vCPU. It's quite different from Linux. In Linux, everything is a task. We have two types of vCPUs. One is a normal vCPU, which vCPU is belonging to a VM or guest. And then we have orphan vCPU, and which means it does not belong to any VM. It will belong to hypervisor itself, and that will be used for background processing. It's basically, orphan vCPU is a kernel thread for Xvisor. Orphan vCPUs are very lightweight compared to normal vCPUs. And like I mentioned, we have a pluggable scheduler. So right now, two scheduling policies we have, fixed priority round robin and fixed priority rate monotonic. And we plan to add the deadline scheduling as well. So in general, the scheduling policies are soft real time. We are not going after hard real time things. The other key aspects are, in Linux, we have two possible contexts in Linux kernel, process context and interrupt context. Over here, we have three possible contexts. One is a normal context, orphan context, and interrupt context. So normal context is when we are handling an interrupt for a normal vCPU, which means we are handling either MMI or trap or stage 2 trap or some kind of trap. And then orphan context is when we are running a background thread. And then interrupt context is when we are handling a host interrupt. So over here, the unique thing about Xvisor is that we only allow orphan vCPUs to sleep, or we can only sleep in orphan context. So normal context and interrupt context are not allowed to sleep, so we cannot have any sleepable logs in those code paths. This ensures that, of course, the interrupt handlers can never block. The trap handling for the guest or VM will never block. So this in turn actually helps us to provide a very predictable delays in handling MMI emulation and trap handling for a guest. So moving on, like this was about Xvisor in general. So let's now talk more about what is there in the RISC-V port of Xvisor. So these are all the software layers of the Xvisor when Xvisor is deployed on a system. So the color coding is same as mentioned previously. So over here, as you can see, it's a monolithic hypervisor, just like Linux is a monolithic kernel. It's just a single software layer providing the complete virtualization service. We don't depend on any other OS for running drivers or emulators or anything. So, and the black boxes shown over here, WhatIO front ends, are actually the existing WhatIO drivers which are there in upstream Linux kernel. So as such, we don't have any code changes in Linux kernel for Xvisor. We just run unmodified Linux kernel out of the box. Yeah, and a typical vCPU context on RISC-V looks like this. We have two parts. One is the ARC regis, which is common for both orphan as well as normal vCPUs. And most of the stuff in ARC regis is save restored at time of every trap and entry, and exit, sorry. And then we have struct RISC-V private, which is only for normal vCPUs, where we have all the vCPU CSRs, additional CSRs that are there for the guest, and all the floating point registers. And yeah, and this will keep growing once we go for virtualizing other extension of RISC-V, like vector extensions. But the ARC regis will pretty much remain as it is. So, yeah, this is a timeline of sequence of events. What happens when we actually get a host interrupt while we are running a VM. So we just enter the HS mode, do the trap entry, and handle it in the interrupt context and go back, okay? So the trap entry will typically just save 31 GPRs and 3 CSRs, that's all. So it's pretty simple. But if you look at other hypers like KVM, you will have a big vault switch where we are switching a lot of GPRs between host and guest and then moving on. So, and how does the context switch happen? So most of the time, the context switch in Xvisor happens in interrupt context when the timer time slice expires or the time allotted to a VM expires. But then orphan vCPUs and normal vCPUs can both even voluntarily give up the CPU as well. So orphan vCPUs can give up by just doing a sleep the normal vCPUs can do a wait for interrupt instruction and then voluntarily give away the CPU. So when a normal when a vCPU is preempted, it will be mostly due to a timer time slice expiry. We'll get a timer interrupt. We'll do a trap entry. This will follow to the host IRQ subsystem, which in turn will go to timer subsystem, and then it will call the scheduler callback, and then scheduler will decide to move out the vCPU and do a RISC-V context switch, which is RISC-V specific, of course, and it will be different for other architectures. So the usual trap entry exit save restore will happen as it is. It's only the context switch which will save restore the private by the right hand side box. So the full context switch will only happen when vCPU is actually scheduled out. And so real-world VMs will tend to have a mix of both pass-through, para-vault, and software-emulated devices. So we cannot really ignore the software-emulated devices, even in embedded world, because on any SoC, the number of devices will be really limited. So we'll end up having some kind of software-emulated devices for the guest or VMs. And when we run RTOSes inside VM, actually, the delays in emulating the MMIO registers is also very important. So the point behind this slide is that we really have predictable delay in MMIO emulation because we don't allow Xvisor code to sleep when we are in normal context, when we are doing any trap emulation or handling a trap for a guest or VM. And the way we handle guest time is quite different. I mean, particularly unlike a lot of other hypervisor, we really don't pre-map the entire guest time into the hypervisor virtual address space. So this gives us two things, actually. We save some memory in the HS mode page table, and we also avoid the cache aliasing problem where we have two separate virtual addresses for the guest RAM pages. One is in the hypervisor and one is in the guest. So, of course, this comes with a price. We need an alternative way to access the guest RAM. So how we do it right now is we access 4 KB at a time. We map the 4 KB page, access it, and unmap it. It is slower, but it can be improved at least on RISC-V. So in RISC-V, we have a special hardware feature called unprivileged load store. Using this, we can just avoid the map and map dance shown over here, and we can get actually very good performance in accessing the guest RAM without even pre-mapping it in HS mode page tables. And just like other hypervisor, we also have huge pages for both, for hypervisor as well as the guest. So this, of course, again helps in performance. We have 2M and 1GB of page sizes in RISC-V 64, of huge page sizes, and 4MB on 32-bit systems. So like mentioned before, we when we are running guest or VM, guest and VM can actually inject software interrupts and timer interrupts using SBI calls. So SBI is nothing but supervisor binary interface in RISC-V world. It's nothing but a syscall style interface between host and guest, and you can easily compare it with the PSCI spec in the ARM world. So currently SBI 0.1 is in use by the Linux kernel, and that's what we even emulate for the guest or VM. And SBI 0.2 is still in draft stage, and we have pretty much defined it. It should be there out soon. And the table over here shows all the existing SBI 0.1 calls. This is going to change a lot. And like mentioned before in the features, another unique thing about Xvisor is that we use device tree for both host as well as guest. So in fact, we have three types of DTs. One is the host DT, which, as the name suggests, describes the host hardware to Xvisor. And Xvisor uses that DT to probe the drivers and all those things. Then we have a guest Xvisor DT, which describes the guest virtual hardware to Xvisor. We don't really have any fixed guest types in Xvisor. It's all probed when all the emulators are probed when the guest is actually created. And we describe the guest memory layout and everything in form of a DT. And then we have guest OS DT, which is like describing the guest virtual hardware to the OS that is going to run inside the guest. So typically it's a Linux DT. And like I mentioned in the features, we can actually do zero copy inter-guest transfers using a combination of shared memory and whatever RP message. Just shared memory is not enough for zero copy because we need asynchronous notifications between the VMs so that we can avoid unnecessary polling. So RP message helps that part. And RP message also helps us with the name service notifications which they have. And essentially, in this setup, what happens is that if you are running Linux inside each guest, the apps will see a separate character device for each other VM. And writing to that character device will just send out a message to other VM. And if the VM goes down, other VM goes down, then the character device will be removed by the UDEV. So it's pretty cool in that, and we are by using whatever IRP message, we are actually avoiding the Linux network stack as well. And so using whatever IRP message is not mandatory as such to do this kind of stuff, but you can also use UDP packets using whatever network. And so moving on, these are some interesting stats of the code base and the binary sizes gathered recently on 21st October, more in context of RV64. So as you can see, the amount of code which gets compiled for RV64 is just 159K lines of code. And bulk of it is just drivers and emulators, actually. And we can actually strip it down further and reduce this a lot. And the binary overall binary size for RV64, 64-bit RISC-V is almost 850 KB, which is pretty less, actually, compared to a lot of the drivers. The thing about KVM, you consider the entire kernel binary size, KVM tool or UQM binary size and the libraries that it depends on. So the binary size, it tells that our text memory is as such very less to achieve the complete solution. And at runtime, we have this concept called VA pools. We restrict the complete memory usage by Xvisor by having a compile time limit called VA pool limit. By default, it's 32 MB. You can even decrease that. And typical usage out of this is 22 MB right now. And when we boot, actually, we further free up 136 KB of memory, just like Linux frees up a lot of init memory. Yeah, so the most important question, why? Why is it ideal for embedded systems? Yeah, so why we think is that there is no dependency on any guest OS for running management tools or drivers. It's a single software, single binary providing you the complete virtualization solution. And the guest types are not fixed. The users can design their own VMs and not even and choose not to even contribute back. You can even come up with micro VMs, small VMs just with few peripherals. It has a soft real-time pluggable scheduler. The MMIO emulation overhead is predictable quite. We follow open standards for para-virtualization like VirtIO. And we have zero-copy inter-guest communication. And our, in general, footprint, memory footprint at runtime is quite low, we believe. And we have a reasonable code size to do the complete virtualization solution. And yeah, it's a perfect playground for academia as well. So we have seen in past a lot of publications and interesting research was coming from, in fact, the spatial and temporal memorization was done by one of the universities, something, things like that. So what is our state as far as RISC-V goes? We had the initial RISC-V port working last year itself, but at that time we didn't have QMU with H extension emulation. So we just booted to prompt and that's all. So we had pretty much the groundwork already ready for H extension. Then once the draft was in good shape, in June we just implemented in both QMU and Xvisor. Currently it's in very good shape, of course. We are able to boot multiple guests with multiple VMs on an SMP host. And we are also able to boot open embedded and Fedora guest OS as well. So it's quite comparable to the Xvisor ARM port as well right now. We were supposed to release the next version of Xvisor by this month itself. It's already a year now from the previous release. But then we want the spec to be in a decent shape. We wanted the 0.5 draft with all the pending changes to be there. And then there are some QMU fixes that we want to go in by the QMU 4.2 release. So if you want to play with Xvisor RISC-V, you can. There is already documentation under docs, RISC-V, RISC-V Vault QMU. And work in progress QMU is found at this location. And you can even write to us by joining to Xvisor Devil Google groups. So what we look at next is we want to get our 32-bit RISC-V port working as well. So it's the same port, just runs in 32-bit mode. Then we also want to add 0.2 support. We want to also have more advanced stuff like paravert time accounting to be defined in SBI 0.2 and also implemented over here. And like mentioned before, we want to access guest time using unprivileged load stores. And then loadable module support. So vector extensions was going to be there in RISC-V as well soon, so we want to virtualize that as well. But of course, this depends on the state of QMU. Then we want to add libvirt support eventually, but yeah, didn't find time so far to do that. But the other parts like adding 32-bit running 32-bit guest on 64-bit guest should be possible now because it's already defined in the spec. We should also be able to do big Indian guest on little Indian host or reverse. That is also defined in spec right now. So yeah, I think we have time for the demo or not. We ran out of time. We have 5 minutes, okay. Yeah, meanwhile, if you have questions, just shoot, I mean. Yeah, please.
Did you port kernel presentizer to XYZ?
Not. It's not. Yeah, it's totally in C, yeah. We didn't put that as in there.
I gave a talk at Linux World Japan about porting kernel address initializer to a very major hypervisor, type 1 hypervisor. I can show you details.
Sure, I'll love to do that, yeah.
And second question, can it debug guests with GDB?
No, we don't have that support, but we generally use QMU thing. So we don't have a debug server running in Xvisor. So basically, even if we do it eventually, we'll need to run GDB server in Xvisor, and then that will help us debug the VMs.
Uh-huh.
But that we don't have right now, actually.
You can
Yeah, we can use QEMU debugging, yes, it can debug both. The trick with that is that you have to figure out using QEMU register state whether you are currently in guest mode or hypervisor mode, because you can break at any point in time when it gets stuck. So that becomes tricky sometimes. Yeah. So I'll just I was going to show by running two VMs. Simple busybox rootfs and just ping. So yesterday Alistair also gave a demo while in his QEMU talk. It's pretty much similar demo. So we cannot go for a complex demo in interest of time, because like booting Fedora takes quite a bit of time right now. So what we have done is actually we just started off the Xvisor build for 64-bit RISC-V. And we are also building the basic firmware. So basic firmware is just like a bootloader which boots up first in the VM, and then that launches the guest Linux. And the other image is like we have already pre-compiled the Linux kernel and also compiled a rootfs for the guest. So generally we provide the guest images to Xvisor in form of initrd or disk. So Xvisor can load guest images from some block device or initrd as well. So after the build completes, we'll just create the Xvisor disk, that the disk that we are going to provide with to Xvisor to load the images in VM. Yeah, any other questions? So the rationale was, so actual devices will require more register traps. So we wanted some paravolt mechanism which requires minimum register trapping. So Xen has his own Xen PV, Hyper-V has his own Hyper-V paravolt channel. Voltaio was kind of neutral to any hypervisor, so we went with Voltaio. And actually it's very few traps, it's only the notifications. So we didn't wanted to make anything too Xvisor specific as well, and we wanted to avoid changes in kernel as well. So we went for Voltaio. Yeah, so we have compiled it. So we'll skip the steps over here in interest of time, and because we already have a pre-compiled guest Linux and guest rootfs, we'll now just create the Xvisor disk that which will have the guest images. So what we have done over here is we had created a small extension to disk image which will pass as a initrd to Xvisor, and it will have guest Linux image. It will also have DT which describes the virtual hardware to Xvisor. It will also have a DT for the guest Linux also. So let's launch it. So right now we compile our QEMU. We don't use just the released QEMU because the hypervisor's H extension emulation patches are still in flight. They might be released with the QEMU 4.2 or higher. So we have booted Xvisor with two VMs. Okay. So you can, there are a lot of commands if you do help. So what it has done at boot time is that after booting, it has mounted its own initrd and created two VMs for us. Okay. You can also create these VMs through just commands. Okay. And if you do host info, it will just tell whatever DT information QEMU has passed to us. So we also, we can list the vCPUs. Everything is a vCPU, right? So even the background threads you will see as threads. So, but the normal vCPUs are named like guest 0, vCPU 0, and guest list is here. So just if you want to start, okay, so this will first start the basic firmware. So basic firmware is like our bootloader, and from there we just boot the Linux. So The host has four CPUs, the VM has two vCPUs. So this is a very basic busy box based rootfs. And if you do cat proc CPU info, you have two vCPUs. And same thing. Any questions? Yeah, there is a what I have net between the VMs. We can have a ping pong between the VMs. So to just assign IP address, some random IP address. Any questions so far? So the message you just saw, like I mentioned, volatile RP message has this name service notifications. When the other guest comes up, you get a notification, the character device gets created automatically. And we can just ping. Questions? I think it's time. Yeah, so we're already up 3 minutes. Okay, cool. Thank you for attending. Yeah.